In some reactions, it's really easy to see the reaction progressing. Sometimes we can see a gas being produced. Sometimes we can see a change in temperature. And sometimes we can see a change in color. Measuring a rate of reaction is a really crucial part of chemistry, especially in a chemical plant. If a reaction is exothermic, then it generates heat as it progresses. And then not understanding the rate of reaction could lead to a huge buildup of temperature and pressure. And then, in the reactions that we've just seen, the changes are quite gradual, and that can make it difficult to know when the reaction is finished. It is possible to measure the rate of reaction if we have the right kit. For a reaction which produces gas, like this fizzy aspirin tablet, we can measure the volume of gas that is produced. We have a rate of reaction. Unfortunately, the units of milliliters per 10 seconds are not very useful. So let's convert them. First, we'll convert it into milliliters per second. Now for the tricky bit. We want to know how those milliliters relate to the molecules reacting in the flask. We know that one mole of gas at standard temperature and atmospheric pressure takes up 24 decimeters cubed of volume. That's 24,000 milliliters. Our number is quite a bit smaller than that. We haven't produced a whole mole of gas molecules yet. So we can take our number of milliliters and divide it by 24,000 to get the number of moles of gas we have produced. So now we've calculated our rate of reaction in moles per second. Measuring the rate of reaction in this way is quite simple because we can measure the volume of gas that's produced. But what about a reaction where a color change happens? Well, we can use a color scale, such as with pH changes and an indicator, or we could use a colorimeter. Matching the color change onto the chart can be quite difficult because the changes are so gradual. Let's see what happens with this reaction. I've got a solution of potassium iodide, sodium thiosulfate, and starch. And I'm going to add a little bit of hydrogen peroxide with a splash of acid. Oh, nothing happened. That's a shame. Maybe it's slow. Ah, the color changed really suddenly. We can time this reaction really easily since there's a well-defined endpoint. In fact, by changing the concentrations of reactants in each solution, we can change the amount of time it takes to see the color change. We could even use reactions like this, like an egg timer. Reactions that change color so suddenly are sometimes known as clock reactions. So what's actually happening here? Well, we have iodide ions in solution, which can react with hydrogen peroxide to form elemental iodine. Iodine, when mixed with starch, gives a dark blue color. That's what we see at the end of the reaction. But why isn't it appearing straight away? Well, a second competing reaction is occurring in the flask at the same time. As soon as the iodine molecules are made, they react with sodium thiosulfate and are turned back into iodide ions. Written down, those two reactions look like this. So how do we work out the rate of reaction? Well, put more simply, the rate of this reaction is just the change in the concentration of chemicals over time. We can write that in a formula showing the concentration of iodine, I2 in square brackets, changing over time, T. Knowing the rate of reaction is important in a lot of chemistry. When you're building a chemical reactor, you need to understand the rate of reaction to keep things safe, but also to keep it economical. Knowing the rate of reaction can also help you to investigate how enzymes function and also help you to work out the mechanism of an organic reaction. And that's the kind of research that we do here at the University of Birmingham.